Hey, looking for a car truck? Search the AutoChannel.com's actual price paid guide to quickly and easily find 100% accurate used car values. Don't get the blues, get smart, not screwed. TheAutoChannel.com, there's nothing else like it.
Okay, good morning, everybody. And I'd just like to make a couple quick introductions. My name is Mike Collarin. I'm the Chief Operating Officer for Saab Cars North America. And on behalf of the Saab Cars North America team and our entire Saab team globally, I'd like to welcome you to the Scandinavian House here in New York City. I'd also like to make a special welcome to our webcast attendees today. I think we have several hundred of you on the line, and we look forward to your questions. Please send those in along the way through the press briefing, and we'll be sure to get as many of them as possible. We've got a great agenda here for you today. You're going to hear from Saab leadership. You're going to hear quite a bit about the new 9.5, a beautiful new piece of Swedish automobile jewelry, a beautiful new car that we are so, so proud of. Also get a chance for our guests here in the room today to go up to the Monticello Driving Club and drive this beautiful new car. So without further delay, I'd like to introduce to you our Chief Executive Officer, Jan-Åke Jansson. Jan-Åke?
Thank you, Mike, and good morning also from my side, and of course to you on the web. Welcome to this this activity. We appreciate, of course, that you sign in, and we're looking forward to of course, your questions by the end of the session. The primary objective from my side is to, of course, talk about the 9.5. And that is also what the agenda in general over this day will actually be focusing its content on. But, you know, what I would like to do is to give you a little bit of a business update also as it relates to Saab, as well as talk a little bit about what has happened so far in the company. Of course, the 23rd of February was a fantastic day for Saab. That was the day that Spyker Cars and General Motors signed the agreement and officially closed the transaction for the purchase of Saab Automobile. And I would say, at the same time, we also signed an agreement with the European Investment Bank and the Swedish government as it relates to a loan for the development of safety and environmentally friendly oriented development projects. And this means that we're exiting that day with a fully funded business plan and, of course, a brand new owner. During this last, I would say, 18 months prior to that date, we have, of course, gone through a tremendous up and down period. And as a company in difficulties called it, we've probably experienced most of what you can do, from typically cost reductions to also getting into reorganizations, liquidations, and other. But I would say that during this period, the tremendous support that we have seen from throughout the world has been just fantastic. Not only did we have 60 caravans in the world that actually supported the saving of Saab, but we also have received, of course, numerous of emails and letters and other communications to keep on going. And that has, of course, had a major impact on the ability, I would say, for the company to start or to find a new future. Should not be underestimated, and we're, of course, very, very grateful to that support. I think it's important to remember, though, that when we started on the 23rd of February, the starting point was actually the end of a 7-week of liquidation of the company. And that meant that if you walked through the production facility at that time, this is what you would see: an empty plant with no material, no cars in production, and but a facility that would be ready to produce cars, provided that we had material on hand. So the result of this liquidation actually caused us to not be able to order material, stop a lot of product developments, no marketing activities. And when we restarted, We actually had were forced to a seven-week shutdown of the plant while we were getting all the suppliers ready to actually deliver material into the plant. What this led to was, of course, that the inventory throughout the world was at its absolutely lowest point, which meant that it made no sense for a lot of marketing activities as we didn't have any cars to sell. What we're happy now to report is, of course, that since almost 4 months, we're back in business as it relates to manufacturing cars. Not only is the assembly line full, but also all the suppliers have ramped up their volumes, and we get deliveries of material as we need. We've also decided during this month to increase the production line rate, which means that we see also that the demand is going in the right direction. We have restarted all the development as it relates to the new vehicles, which is, of course, also why we are able at this point to actually launch the new 9.5, also here in the U.S. We have, during this period, also made the first drawdowns of the loan from the European Investment Bank, three different tranches at an approximate total amount of $190 million have been received into the company. We have also gradually increased our marketing activities as we see volume increasing in the out in the marketplace. And a key foundation for being able to do that is, of course, that you have the financing, not only of your dealer inventory, but also retail financing in place. And we have, during this period, signed an agreement with GMAC for many of our markets where GMAC is present. Other cooperation activities that have happened during this period is that we have started a project for the manufacturing of a test fleet of 100% electrical vehicles. This test fleet will be about 100 cars that will be available in the first quarter of next year. And it's mainly a test fleet that will provide us input and learnings as it relates to electrical vehicles, and many of those components will, of course, then later on be incorporated in our vehicles. We have also signed an agreement as it relates to design support. We've hired Jason Castriota, who is a very famous auto designer, to actually be the chief designer for Saab, and of course his primary focus will be the new 9.3, at least in the immediate terms. In December of last year, we signed an agreement with Beijing Automotive in terms of selling intellectual properties of our previous 9.5 as well as an older version of the 9.3. And we have continued, of course, our discussions with Beijing Automotive to explore further opportunities in the Chinese market. And many other partnerships are being discussed at this point. Last but not least, I would say the focus during the last 5 months have, of course, been to create this standalone company, to gradually separate from General Motors in terms of taking over responsibilities that previously was done by GM. We've hired some key executives into the company, and we've also hired people into the manufacturing arena as well as the staff function. In total, about 300 people have been hired during this period so that we gradually can take over the responsibilities and create this new standalone company. A key activity has been the responsibility for the sales side, where General Motors was responsible for 23 countries where their sales organizations were responsible for the selling and marketing of our vehicles. And we have, since July 1st, created our own structure. So now it's Saab Automobile that has the full responsibility for the sales and marketing throughout the world. And, of course, we have had a lot of other activities. This is just to mention, give you a highlight of the key major progress that we made. And as we come into this process, I would say it gives us more and more confidence that we're on the right track, and we're more and more confident that we'll be able to deliver upon our business plan. And this is, of course, what will also happen in the next couple of months, to continue, in particular, to create this standalone company And that means that, of course, we have a lot of activities to do, but we feel that we're on the right track. A key activity is, of course, to rebuild confidence out in the marketplace. During this last 18 months, of course, a lot has been said and written about Saab, and it's important for us now to rebuild the confidence, to get customers back into the showrooms, to get dealers to be committed to the brand, and suppliers, of course, to be able to deliver into the plant. Our feeling is that the best way to do that is, of course, to deliver on the business plan by executing exactly what we have said. And, of course, the new 9.5 is a good starting point in that direction. If we look at the strategy going forward, we have divided our strategy into basically three key focus areas. One is the operational side, the other is the brand, and last but not least, of course, our cars going forward. If we look at the operational side, we will concentrate all of our activities to Trollhättan, Sweden. That's where all the product development will be done, manufacturing, sales and marketing will be managed out of there, as well as any other staff function. On the manufacturing side, we will build all the cars there except the 9.4X, the crossover vehicle that will be built at the GM plant in Mexico as originally planned. And there are many, many reasons for us continuing in that direction. But apart from that, all the activities will be concentrated to Trollhättan. And we have already transferred the manufacturing of the convertible into the Trollhättan plant, and we're building, for the first time in our history, convertibles in Sweden and in Trollhättan. The second element of our strategy is, of course, the brand as such, and I'd like you to show this movie. I think this is a fantastic commercial, actually, that goes back way in time. And this year, actually, the Saab 96 celebrates its 50th anniversary. And when you look at this commercial, I would say, in particular, it's interesting when you talk about colors and you show it all in black and white. I think that's pretty challenging. But anyway, that's a side comment. But why I'm showing this commercial is that during that, I would say the last 2 years, we have, I think, understood that the brand has a tremendous heritage, a heritage that is invaluable for us as a company. Going back 63 years in time for a car company from Sweden, I think is actually an astounding accomplishment. And what we see is that this heritage is very important, not only to our historical buyers, but also to the future buyers. That creates authenticity as it relates to the brand values, etc. I myself had the opportunity, together with Victor Müller, to drive the famous classical car race in Italy, Mille Miglia. And here you have a car race over 1,000 miles, where the contenders are Ferraris, Maseratis, Aston Martins, Mercedes, and two-stroke Saab 96 from 1957. Being a part of that whole classical car race showed really what kind of brand value that Saab has. And this is something that we really need to take also into the future. To take our heritage with you into the future is going to be key as we develop our company, as we develop the brand, and as we develop the new vehicles to come. It was an amazing experience that has also, I think, raised the awareness among the Saab Automobile staff, our dealers, and others that the heritage we have is tremendous. And to make Saab even more unique than maybe what we are today, we feel is one of the key cornerstones in making this a successful company as we go into the future. If I go to the third element of our strategy, the vehicles as such, of course, we're here to talk about the new 9.5. The new 9.5 sedan, which actually is replacing a 13-year-old 9.5, is a gigantic step, of course, up in the very competitive premium segment. The 9.5 has all the characteristics as it relates to what you need to have to compete with, in particular, the Audi A6, the BMW 5 Series, and the likes. If you look at the premium segment, you can actually divide the segment into a number of different sub-segments. But I think what this chart shows is that the expectation by 2020 is that the premium segment will have a total of 8 million new cars sold every year. In other words, a significant growth compared to what you see today. The subsegments in this very important premium segment is, of course, divided based upon size of vehicle, you can say. You have the upper segment, where you have Audi A8s as an example, and you have the lower side, which is the, if I use Audi, the Audi A1 type of vehicles. We are today competing in three of these subsegments, with the 9.3, the 9.4X, and the 9.5. In other words, as you can see, we cover a significant portion of these subsegments, or of the total segment as well. The upper segment is a segment that we do not intend to enter into, but I would say that the lower segment, a car below the Saab 9.3, is a very important opportunity for us. We're looking at it. We have defined what kind of vehicle we need. We don't have it in our business plan yet, but rest assured that this is one of our top priorities. If you look at the 9.5, and the subsegment of the 9.5, that's where you have the Audi A6, the BMW 5 Series as an example. And the 9.5 is, of course, a serious contender to these vehicles, both in terms of size, in terms of performance, engine size, comfort, electronics, you know, everything you need in this very, very important segment. And size is, of course, a key issue when you buy these type of vehicle. At the same time, you need to keep the CO2 levels very low in today's society. And as it relates to our vehicles, the technology of smaller displacement, turbocharged engines, will be the key as we go into the future. And of course, the 9.5 has only turbocharged engines, which should be the case for every Saab as we go into the future. The element about CO2 developments is critical. And of course, the loan that we have received from EIB is forcing us to actually also utilize that money towards environmental friendly developments, which is very appropriate for the Saab brand, in particular based upon our Swedish origins. So a lot of developments will continue to happen, not only as it relates to new cars, but also as it relates to CO2 improvements. If you look at our overall strategy then, we are working our way through the development of new cars, which means the 9.5 sedan launching as we speak. After the vacation, the Mahler 11 9.3 will be launched with significant CO2 improvements. In April of 2011, the 9.4X, the first entry into the crossover segment, will be in the market. And in the middle of the summer next year, in July 2011, the wagon version of the 9.5 will be starting its production. And in 2012, the all-new 9.3 will be available for sale in the marketplace. That means that in 2012, the oldest car that we'll have available in the showrooms is actually the car that we're launching today, a situation that we at Saab have never, ever experienced before. Our ambitions is to reach 120,000 to 125,000 cars per year. globally with a break-even point of 85,000, and that we will achieve when we have replaced the entire portfolio 2012, as I indicated earlier. In these volume numbers, the United States will continue to be the biggest market for Saab and typically represent anywhere between 20 and 25% of our total volume. In other words, a lot of focus will continue to be in the important U.S. market. So if I summarize our situation as we go forward, I would say we're in the fortunate position of having a fully funded business plan. We have brand new cars around the corner. We have good agreements with General Motors as it relates to availability of components, license agreements for technology, et cetera. And we are developing alliances and partnerships as we proceed into the future. With this, as you can say, a basic part of the business plan, as a standalone company, we decide priorities, we decide what technology to use, and we are the ones that actually drive the business going forward. A great position to be in, and we're getting more and more confident as we proceed into the new era of Saab and are looking forward, of course, to creating this very successful brand and company that we're all waiting to see happen. With that, I'd like to thank you for your attention, and I now have the privilege to introduce the chairman of Saab Automobile, as well as the CEO of Spyker Cars, Victor Miller. Victor.
Thank you, Jan-Åke. Good morning. First of all, this is a good place to thank all those Saab enthusiasts that have supported the brand in this very difficult period of time when the company was almost on the verge of extinction. This past weekend, Jan-Åke and myself went down to Aurora, Ohio, to meet with the Saab Owner Convention, and clearly this brand has something special. I don't think there is any other car brand that has experienced what Saab has experienced in terms of suffering, but also in terms of support from the enthusiasts' base. I don't think there's any other brand that has seen 60 convoys of Saab enthusiasts going to the roads, holding up safe Saab signs, and actually succeeding. So what we did last weekend and the weekend before when we had the Saab Festival in Trollhättan is we symbolically thanked all of those that made such an effort to support us, the acquiring company Spyker, and Saab in particular, with this tremendous struggle, which, of course, as we all know by now, has successfully been concluded. The question that we've been asked so many times over the past few months is, how on earth did this all happen? How could it be that a relatively small player like Spyker could actually acquire Saab? And our explanation is really pretty straightforward. We felt that the perfect storm that raged in this industry in 2008 and 2009 caused a very unusual set of circumstances. The largest car maker in the world, General Motors, went through Chapter 11, something that nobody had ever anticipated possible. Under those circumstances, it was forced to rationalize its product and brand portfolio, and four brands were put up for sale and had to go: Saab, Pontiac, Hummer, and Saturn. Well, the rest is history. The other three didn't make it, and Saab fortunately did. And of course, all this was very much prompted by the fact that General Motors for the development of our future product. Particularly, for instance, if we look at the new Saab 92, assuming that we can ever build it, it will be clearly very much hinging on the brand, on the values and the brand values and the DNA of the original Saab 92. Teardrop shaped, but definitely not retro. A very modern car, but bearing in mind constantly where this car came from, particularly if you think of where Saab was in the 50s and 60s, dominating what we now call the segment A of the market.
Okay, thank you, Victor. Question for Jan-Åke, relating to alternate fuel technologies. Any plans to bring in biopower vehicles to the USA or diesel to the USA?
Well, first of all, I would say that all the vehicles that we develop in the future will have capabilities, of course, to utilize alternative fuel, and specifically there, of course, E85, which is what's the base for the biopower application. And they are also, of course, available for a market, for any market, I would say, throughout the world. The problem with that is, of course, that you need an infrastructure in order to get the benefit of it. And that infrastructure today is basically only built in the markets where we participate. It's, of course, only Sweden that has a significant infrastructure. So the capability is there. It's just a matter of when the market is ready for it, and then we're ready to go. As it relates to biodiesel, it is, of course, a little bit more complicated because that also has to do with what type of biodiesel it is, what's the origin as it relates to the creation of biodiesel. But I'm sure that will also come. And we see also in Europe an increased focus on diesel, and whereas here in the U.S., diesel is still a relatively low volume. I wouldn't be surprised if that will also develop in U.S. market.
Okay, Janoki, a couple more product questions for you. Will the electric vehicle test fleet be spun off the Saab 9.5 or the 9.3?
It will be based on the 9.3.
And do you have any plans for hatches in the future?
That's a good question, and this is, of course, something that we're looking at for the new Saab 9.3. I cannot at this point talk about too much of the details exactly what kind of body size we will have, but we have to return to that question. Hatchbacks is, of course, the heritage of Saab. We used to own that segment in the premium segment, so of course we're looking at it, but I cannot comment anything more than that.
Okay, a couple of U.S.-based questions. Thank you, Janoki. And North American-based questions. First of all, when will the new 9.5 appear in U.S. showrooms? We're loading boats as we speak. Yesterday, a ship left the ports in Sweden with approximately 250 units on board. Another ship leaves in just a couple of days with another 100 or so vehicles. So the supply pipeline will fill very quickly, and we should see units landing in U.S. dealerships in early August with a strong flow of product into the mid-August time frame. So we're on the verge of selling this brand new vehicle in just a few days.
Thanks for watching the Auto Channel. For more great automotive information and entertainment, visit theautochannel.com, the Internet's most complete and comprehensive automotive information resource.